BPI, and we are going to be talking about what listing agents say and to be ready for it when they actually come knocking on the door. When you invite them into your home and you say, hey, listen, can you list my home? Can you actually put my home on the market? These are the top things that they'll actually eventually say to potentially get your listing. We got a good healthy list going on. So there's obviously a multitude of reasons that you would probably hire an agent. We've talked about that. There's also things that you should maybe be concerned about when hiring an agent, whether that's the person, the brokerage, the value they're giving, the price, and all those other jazzes. That's in another video. You can check that out on our YouTube channel or on our Facebook page, wherever you guys get your content. For the first one is that they buy the listing. Okay, so obviously a lot of agents will probably not like this, but essentially this is what they do. And for me, it's not frustrating. I've kind of come to accept it when there are either desperate agents or agents that are new in the business. They will say or do a lot of things just to get the listing. Unfortunately, just not aligning the expectations for the client, and then it sits on the market, the client gets mad, and then I come in the second time around or the third time around and they say, what are you gonna do different? And if only the agent, and by the way, there's tons of amazing agents, and I wish all of the owners hired us or them instead of the ones that, you know, do these things. So the first one is they buy the listing. So in other words, say your home is worth $1 million. Some agents, they'll come in knowing there's two other agents or three other agents that the owner is meeting with, and they'll say, I could get you 1-1. In a normal market, in a down market, or in a buyer's market, that's impossible. Buyers have their choice. Buyers are not going into this mad frantic mode and saying, I'm emotionally gonna pay $100,000 more for this apartment. Okay, if it's in a seller's market or if it's a crazy low inventory market, that may be the case. That only happens about maybe 2 to 2.5 years out of every cycle. In other words, every up and then down cycle. There's always those pinnacles, those troughs, or those crests, I should say. I don't know my waves, but those crests where people are just willing to pay outlandish pricing, and it's kind of like tick, 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 tick on a roller coaster, and they're willing to pay that because they know if they don't pay that someone else will. Buying the listing, be careful with this. And the reason being is that when an agent says, I'll put it on at 1-1, okay? I'll put it on overpriced, knowing it's overpriced, knowing that the comparables don't actually add up to this number. Guess what happens? It sits on the market, it's frustrating, they keep on doing open houses, they don't have anyone coming through, and then you keep on asking the question, where are the people? Where are the buyers? Where are my offers? And the agent says, no, they're coming. They prop up, well, I put it here. Then they start advertising on New York Times, even though nobody comes through New York Times. They keep on doing open houses, even though nobody's coming to the open houses. And in the beginning, if they aligned the expectations, it would be a little bit different on pricing. Number two, they promise anything. This industry is extremely, extremely volatile. In other words, not the marketplace, but you could say, I will put it on at $1 million, and then out of nowhere, the Fed raises rates, or out of nowhere, you know, something happens geopolitically or even globally. And on top of that, they promise, you know, I'm gonna get you $1 million, or they promise it's gonna be sold in 6 or 3 months. It's gonna be sold after the first open house. I'm gonna get a bidding war. Watch out for the promises. Watch out for the time frame and the duration, just over-promising, because it's really, really hard. There's times that I said, I'm gonna get the asking price immediately. That's what I'm thinking, I don't say it. But, and the reason being is that I would rather under-promise and over-deliver. Or you could promise and then over-deliver, but that doesn't really work out. And then the client isn't really happy. The seller isn't happy because they said, well, no, actually you said it was gonna be a bidding war. Or actually you said it was gonna go after the first open house. So watch out for the promises. It's really hard to understand when things are gonna close. You know, we're in situations right now where there's health concerns on a multitude of people. We have an attorney, we have on one deal, we have, you know, a seller on another deal. We have all these folks that, you know, is gonna push that out. So there's no guarantee. We had something, with a neighbor in one of our other listings. There's no guarantees in this business that it's going to close immediately. Third one, discount brokers. This, my friends, is going to be an entirely new video in of itself, because discount brokers, they're coming on. The thing is, you can't really scale out discount brokers. You can, but then you're bringing on interns. And the reason being is that if someone's willing to work for an extremely low price, that means they're willing to give up money on your purchase price. They're willing to give up negotiations that myself or someone else would stand firm. So when someone says, I'm gonna list it at $50, you say, okay, well, how are you living? You know, what are you going to do for $50? You know, obviously that is an extreme example. However, I've heard some crazy numbers and I say, well, actually the buyer's agent expects this amount, or actually if you want, for us, we're spending at least $1,000 per listing, at least minimum. No guarantee it's going to sell. And that's just standard. And actually when we start advertising marketing and we start printing out premier brochures and we start doing a little bit more, you're up to like 1500 or 2000. And then if there's even more expensive, you start getting the numbers up there. So you find out if someone is willing to take a $2,000 commission, and I'm willing to spend a minimum of $2,000, or someone else is willing to spend $2,000, guess who's gonna defend your price a little bit more? Guess who's gonna defend the closing or the transaction or including or excluding things in the home? Guess who's gonna be able to create a bidding war or gonna be able to actually represent your home properly? That's really what it comes down to. I think the allure, I understand it. And it's nothing on the seller or anyone else. I understand the allure of someone saying, I'm gonna charge half of someone else. But if you actually put that into dollar terms, so say it's $1 million, and that $1 million, and someone's willing to do it for 5%, or someone's willing to do it for 6%, okay? This is for a listing. That's only $10,000. In percentage terms, between 5% and 6%, that's a lot. But between absolute dollar amount terms, it's only $10,000. I can easily make up $10,000 in negotiation. Easily. That's without a question. You know, so that's the way that I frame it, is this person that's willing to do it for less, why are they willing to take it for less? What are they not providing? Whether it's marketing, whether it's showing, they're gonna have an intern, they're gonna have someone that's brand new in the industry, you know, things like that. You guys understand. The fourth thing, I have a buyer. I do tons of deals in this building. Okay, great, let's see your past history. Okay, great, you have five homes on the market in this building, or three homes or two homes on the market. There's a lot of things that are gonna happen. Number one is that person, that broker, is gonna push the other homes before they push yours, because yours is brand new onto the market. They're gonna wanna sell the other ones. And then you ask, why are they still on the market if you're such a good broker? Or you just ask the broker, you say, oh, you have a buyer? Bring them through. Let's just do this off market. Why do we even need to put it on the market? You know, so these are things where they may have a buyer. And by the way, there's agreements. I just did, but we're hopefully gonna go into a transaction where I have the buyer of a bar and someone that's selling a bar. Completely off market, the seller called me, the buyer I contacted, I'm putting them together. I could have been like, no, I'm not bringing the buyer. We're listing this. I just said, I actually have a buyer. Let's bring them through. I showed them the place. It was prime time. We're getting the financials to the buyer, and hopefully we're gonna get an offer and a decision. So always say, yeah, bring them through, bring the buyer through. Fifth thing, I can reach them internationally. My firm is amazing. Well, first of all, when it comes down to it, every firm doesn't really matter anymore, because the internet has completely democratized everything. So in other words, this is the best way to think about it. When you go on Amazon, so I recently, I'm training for a triathlon, and on Amazon, I'm buying equipment. I don't even know who they're not Speedo, they are not TYR, which is another popular swimming brand. You know, I don't even know who they, I don't know where they're made. I just know that other people have liked this through great reviews and comments on Amazon. And there's 1,000 reviews, I'm buying that product. I don't know who it is. It's the same thing, is that someone, say I'm representing a home, BPI. It's not, you know, Corcoran, Elliman, Brown Howard Stevens, Halstead, Compass, Sotheby's, you know, all these other firms. Doesn't really matter about the firm. Maybe back in the day, but not today. Okay, they only find it through two ways, Street Easy and through a broker, okay? The firm doesn't really matter, which goes into the next one, is the marketing. My marketing is the best. My marketing is top notch. Listen, when it really comes down to it, it comes down to the person, okay? A lot of brokers are gonna disagree, but one broker is better at selling. One broker knows how to influence and get offers out of people. One broker knows how to actually get the price and defend the price, or defend the transaction, defend the home, or solution oriented. There's just better brokers. If all the things were the same, in other words, the firm was the same, the marketing was the same, there is a massive gap between the top and the bottom portions of brokers. There's what, 40,000 brokers here in New York City because of the $1 million listing show? When they say, my marketing is the best, watch out. When they say, my reach, my international reach. And I'll just go back to that for a second. The reason being is that if I'm buying a home in Tokyo, if I'm buying a home in London, even if I'm buying a home in Boston, I don't know Boston at all. Even if it was like Hoboken, okay, I'm in Manhattan. Hoboken is literally a mile and a half away. It might even be closer, I have no idea. I just take three train stops, and maybe even two train stops, I'm in Hoboken. I don't know Hoboken. I don't know the good areas, the bad areas, where the areas were affected by Sandy. I don't know pricing. I don't know anything about it. I'm a real estate agent. Yes, I know how to research it, but I'm not looking at Hoboken. I'm looking at Manhattan. I know the areas of Manhattan. I know the inventory levels. I know the pricing levels. I know how many have sold, how many have closed, how many are in contract. I know Manhattan really well. I have an idea of Hoboken, but if I'm buying a place in Hoboken, even me as a real estate agent, I'm working with a broker in Hoboken. So in other words, you guys, for number five, reaching internationally. So when they say, my firm is amazing, where reach is international, that person is working with a broker. And if they're working with a broker, my listing is gonna be available to that broker, or your listing is gonna be available to that broker. If they are international and they're aware of Street Easy, Trulia, and Zillow, which are all one company now, they're gonna be going on those websites, which, by the way, your listing is gonna be there. Me advertising in the Shanghai Daily or the Tokyo Times someone's not gonna read that, which is probably thousands of dollars, you know, to actually advertise. No one's gonna read that and be like, oh my God, my home in New York City, I'm ready to buy. That doesn't happen. So these are the six things they'll promise. I hope you guys are aware and ready for them, because some of them, you know, people, they get excited and sellers say, oh my gosh, you can international reach, or your marketing is incredible. Not many brokers do video, okay? I say this is an added bonus, but myself is actually what you're hiring, okay? You're not hiring my video, you're not hiring my firm, you're not hiring anything but me to do your open houses and your showings. It's the same thing with you guys that are sellers. You're not hiring Elliman or Corcoran or Brown Harris Stevens, you're hiring the actual agent, you're not hiring their marketing. They're all pretty much the same. Yes, the show sheets could be nicer. Yes, I provide video and I have a newsletter and I advertise on social media. I do all those things, and it's thousands of dollars per, you know, 1,000 minimum, 1,500. Actually, it might be even more now because a lot of the pricing has gone up. But hope you guys are ready for that. If you guys have any questions, leave in the comments below. Can't wait for all the agents to reach out and say that they didn't like this video. Have an amazing day. And again, charles@botenston.com is my email, BPI. Talk to you guys soon.